So, with chapter 7, microbial metabolism, we are going to eventually get into major catabolic processes like cellular respiration, both aerobic and anaerobic respiration, and fermentation. But we're going to start with sort of the basics of metabolism, including enzyme function and how enzymes work. When we talk about metabolism, we're talking about all of the chemical reactions of the cell. Every type of reaction that happens and their sort of combined effect. These include both anabolic reactions, or what we term anabolism. And your anabolic reactions, these are also often referred to as building reactions. Because what's going to happen is we're going to take smaller molecules and put them together to make larger molecules. I always think of these as a great example of the use of that monomer polymer system that we talked about in chapter 6. Okay. Now, the issue here is that anabolic reactions require energy. Okay. And this is energy in the form of ATP. So, monomers and energy will be utilized to make larger polymers, which then can later be utilized to make even larger polycule, even larger polymers. It depends upon what it is that you're trying to make. When it comes to catabolic reactions, these are what we consider breaking reactions, where the bonds of larger molecules are actually broken and smaller molecules are formed. Okay? So larger molecules get broken into smaller molecules, and as those bonds are broken, energy is released. Okay? Now, this is great because the catabolic reactions and the anabolic reactions are basically feeding one another, and you get this nice cyclic interaction. Okay. You can also refer to these as exergonic and endergonic reactions, with an exergonic reaction being a reaction that releases energy. So this is another take of catabolic reactions, and the endergonic reactions are driven forward with the addition of energy. So these are reactions that we add energy into. So the ATP and the monomers, again, endergonically being used to make larger molecules, and the larger molecules broken apart to fuel an exergonic style catabolic reaction that creates smaller molecules and releases energy in the process. So your book refers to this as the simplified model of metabolism. What we're showing you here is that at the base, okay, we see catabolism. We've got to have those smaller molecules and ATP in order to fuel, okay, this larger anabolic processes. Okay, where we take things like small precursor molecules and turn them into monomers or building blocks, and then those monomers will be used to make macromolecules, and their macromolecules utilized together to make entire cells or possibly entire organisms. So, who's responsible for all of this? Well, that would be the enzymes. Okay. If you recall from chapter 6, enzymes are proteins. Okay. The vast majority of enzymes are built of proteins. Some of them might require helpers, or that we call cofactors. Your big definition, enzymes are catalysts that increase the rate of chemical reaction without becoming part of the product or being consumed in the reaction. In other words, the enzyme is not part of the end result of the reaction, and the enzymes are reusable. They're great recyclable molecules. You can use them over and over again. I always tell people to think about enzymes like your oven. You can use it to cook, and when you're done, you can use it to cook something else, and when you're done, you can use it to cook something else. Okay? The oven doesn't become a part of your food, or hopefully it doesn't, and it's not gone at the end of the reaction. The end of the cooking cycle, you can cook anything else you want to. You can use it over and over again. Okay. So, we're going to spend some time now talking about sort of qualities and characteristics of enzymes. So, how do enzymes work? Okay. Well, enzymes bind a substrate. In other words, the substrate is what the enzyme works on. It's also called the reactant. Okay. And enzymes and their substrates must bond together. You have to form what's called the enzyme substrate complex. Okay. In other words, the enzymes and the substrates have got to bond with one another for the reaction to proceed. The enzyme directly helps change the substrate, either by adding to it or breaking it apart or possibly changing its shape. It depends upon the substrate and the enzyme. At the end of the change, the enzyme will release the substrate and the enzyme is free to be used to grab onto a new substrate and start the reaction over and over and over again. Okay. Enzymes work extremely quickly to produce enough product to maintain living organisms and their metabolic needs. Enzyme speed calculated, it's the number of substrate molecules converted per enzyme per second. To give you some examples, catalase is relatively fast, and if you remember, catalase is what we were using to break down hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. That's that bubbling reaction we've referred to. Catalase works in the order of several million hydrogen peroxide molecules converted to oxygen and water per catalase enzyme per second. That is fast. Okay. Lactate dehydrogenase is slightly slower. Okay. For example, it's going to work at about 1,000 molecules, lactate molecules, converted per enzyme per second. Now, that's slow for an enzyme. Those several million is a little bit more on par with your average enzyme. Okay. You can see, if you're very visual, these enzymes coming together. Here's your enzyme-substrate complex, where the enzyme and the substrates actually touch one another. Okay. In this particular reaction, the enzyme is breaking apart the substrate molecule. This one is mentioned here because it doesn't fit. Okay. Enzymes are very specific for their substrates. It's something we call enzyme specificity. Okay. It works like a lock and a key. Only certain keys fit certain locks. Only certain substrates fit certain enzymes. Okay. And you have to make that exact fit to form this enzyme substrate complex and have the reaction proceed. Okay. Now, when it comes to enzymes, the type of enzyme you're dealing with has a lot to do with what the enzyme is made of. This will include simple enzymes that are made of just a protein portion. They're completely functional, but all they need is a protein folded into the correct three-dimensional structure to function. Okay? And what we call conjugated enzymes, that I always say are proteins plus a partner. Okay, they contain a protein portion and a non-protein portion. The two have to work together to actually be functional. Okay, these are also sometimes referred to as holoenzymes. The protein portion of the conjugated enzyme by itself is referred to as an apoenzyme. I always tell people I remember this. It's a part of an enzyme. Specifically, it's the protein portion of the enzyme. And when you put it together with a cofactor, which can be an organic molecule called a coenzyme, or an inorganic element, we just refer to these as cofactors. Both of them are types of cofactors. The inorganic elements, like metal ions, just get called cofactors. Organic molecules get specifically called coenzymes. When you put cofactors together, with an apoenzyme, the result, is a fully functioning holoenzyme. So you take a part of an enzyme and its cofactor and put them together to get a holoenzyme. Okay. Also known as a conjugated enzyme. Depends on how many pieces you need. If all you need is the protein, it's a simple enzyme. If it's got a partner, it's a conjugated enzyme. Okay. Classifying enzymes and their functions. I'm going to go over a few of these. I'm not going to hit this terribly hard because I don't need you to memorize all of these types of enzymes. But one thing I do like to mention is that very often you can figure out what an enzyme does based upon its name. Okay. Usually you get a prefix or a stem word That has something to do with either the substrate that the enzyme is acting upon or the type of reaction that it's running. And then this ending of ACE. Okay, that's your big clue. This is an enzyme. It has a function. It's going to do something. Okay. For example, in the last go round, we saw. Sorry about that. Okay. We saw lactate dehydrogenase. Okay. As an example enzyme. I always tell people read these from the back. So ACE is your first section. The dehydrogenase is your second section. The lactate is your third section. So read them backwards. 1, 2, 3. Okay. ACE means it's an enzyme. Okay. Dehydrogenase, it removes hydrogens, okay, from lactate. Lactate dehydrogenase. It's the enzyme that removes hydrogens from lactate. Okay. Read them backwards. Okay. Examples of these: oxidoreductases that run redox reactions. Okay. Dehydrogenases, it says it right here. It's a type of oxidoreductase, important because these are going to transfer hydrogens. And if you remember hydrogen, hydrogen has one electron. So every time you move a hydrogen, you move an electron. That's effectively an oxidation reduction reaction. Okay. Transferases that transfer groups. Hydrolases that run hydrolysis reaction. Lyases that break double bonds. They lyse double bonds. Isomerases that move things from isometric forms. Ligases, this one will come in important in the next unit. Anytime you see lig, we're saying to tie or to connect together, to bind. Ligases run dehydration synthesis reactions. And if you remember, a dehydration synthesis reaction removes water and attaches molecules to one another. Okay, so we're forming bonds in those reactions. Do not get caught up in the thought that all enzymes are breaking things down. I see that very, very often. An enzyme breaks things. An enzyme breaks things down. The enzyme is, you know, breaking this down. That's not the only thing enzymes do. Okay? Enzymes are also responsible for all of the anabolic reactions that take place, okay, for building things. And we show people formulas like this all the time. I want to put A plus B together to make C. Well, when you see that arrow, there's an enzyme there. Okay? Everywhere you see arrows in chemical reactions, what you're going to say is there's an enzyme there, at least one. Okay? There's an enzyme making that reaction take place, or at least making it take place as quickly as you would need it to happen to maintain life. More specific examples, all of these end up being breaking reactions. Carbohydrates, we can't agree on how to talk about breaking proteins. Protonases, proteases, and peptidases. Lipases for fats. Deoxyribonuclease, which no one says. We all say DNAs to digest DNA. And then these building reactions, these anabolic reactions. Okay, synthetases, synthases, or polymerases, all bonding molecules together. So we see catabolic and anabolic reactions fueled by enzymes. Now, another thing that's going to become particularly important to us are the functionality of metabolic pathways. We're going to see a lot of metabolic pathways coming up when we talk about things like cellular respiration. Okay? Most of the time, reactions occur in multi-step processes. Okay, like a series or what we call a pathway. Okay, the big gist here and that your definition for a metabolic pathway is where the product of one reaction, okay, is the substrate for the next. So if you see right here, turning A into B is one reaction. Okay. Well, turning B into C is a separate reaction. Okay. Now, what doesn't get mentioned here very specifically, but that I'm definitely going to mention, okay, is that, okay, in this instance, okay, B is the product of the blue reaction, Okay, A to B. And B is the substrate for that sort of orangish-yellow reaction, B to C. Okay, so the product of one reaction becomes the substrate for the next. You can say the same thing about C. Product of B to C becomes the substrate for C to D. Okay, this is what it means to be a metabolic process. Okay, think about, I always tell people, think about what your clothes are made of, and most of the time people say cotton. Okay. It's not cotton. You're not picking jeans straight out of a field. Okay? It's cotton that gets turned into thread, thread that gets woven into cloth, cloth that gets turned into jeans or that gets turned into towels. Okay? That it's a process, a multi-step process. Okay? So types of enzymatic pathways. We see your basic linear pathway, which you're pretty used to. That's what this is up here. Okay? Sort of this big end result product. Okay. The ones that people seem to have the most issue with are the cyclic pathways, mainly because there's not a big end product for the cyclic pathways. The gist here is that as long as you feed the pathway, okay, as long as it's got a substrate or some input, the pathway continues. Okay. We'll recreate and recreate these compounds over and over as long as we put N to the pathway. Okay. Now, in a cyclic pathway, because there's no big end product, these intermediates in here are not necessarily the most important portion of the pathway. The thing you want to pay attention to are these byproducts. Okay? These byproducts are the real products of the pathway. They're the important stuff. So that's where you want to sort of lend your focus when you're talking about cyclic pathways like the Krebs cycle. Okay? We see branched pathways, both divergent, where the pathway splits. Remember, I talked about cloth being made into towels or jeans. Or convergent pathways where the pathways come together. If you have a shirt that's made of cotton and silk, okay? Or you want to take all of your bio courses, okay? And your nursing courses and eventually have them end up getting you a nursing degree, okay? At some point in time, all of the information comes together, okay? To make you an ADN graduate. So, I'm going to stop here. I'll talk a little bit about regulating enzyme functions in the next video. Okay. So, we'll talk about regulation in chapter 7, part 2.